Futures and options on futures trading involve substantial risk and is not a suitable investment for all types of investors. Past results are not necessarily indicative of future results. When I use the word I in this video, it refers to what I teach in my charting course or what I offer in my twice daily oral and written updates. Prices shown on charts and quote boards are in real time and take into account all known activity up to this point in time. And if you'd like to read more of this disclaimer, simply hit the pause key on your video player.
Good day, all. Ira Epstein of Linn Associates with your financial market wrap-up. And this is for Monday, the 7th of May, 2018. And the time right now, well, we're just around 4:40 p.m. Central Daylight Time. Now, before I get any further, I am going to be holding a live webinar this May 10th. That's this coming Thursday at 12:30 p.m. Central Daylight Time. You're going to see during the course of the video the link that you can click up here, and that'll take you to the registration page. If you have questions, you can go to www.iraepstein.com/webinar. Got that? You can always play this back, so I know you will, and I'll talk about this at the end of everything. So one of the elephants in the room that we've had, and there's a number of them, but one of them has been Iran, and the president is going to make an announcement on Tuesday, that's tomorrow, and it's going to be at 2 p.m. Eastern time, and he's going to announce his decision. Now, while you see crude oil right now up $1.01 on the close, believe me, it was down near unchanged by the end of the day, losing that 100-point gain, a good chunk of it. Settlement prices are very different than where the last trades take place in a market in a number of the financial markets. I've explained that over and over. So we'll see if the market's able to hold up. There's so many variables. The president can step out, not put sanctions on Iran. The president can stay in, extend the time in some manner. He can just walk away from the whole thing and say his hands are up, nobody's able to solve anything. And whatever he does, what makes you think Iran's going to negotiate? So at least this elephant, part of it at least, is going to put its front paw out and then the back, and it's going to walk through. That still leaves China. And as I view what happened over the meeting on Thursday and Friday, nothing. They talked, and that's what the Chinese news played up. They said the success was that everybody talked at the table. Okay, that sounds far away from me on all the ideas. And the soybean market down 25 cents is one of our biggest buyers, is now got their own country's importers, the people that run the businesses, saying, you know, they normally would buy, but they don't know what the tariff's going to be. They're going to look elsewhere. They can't do business that way. And that's the big unknown at this point. Admittedly, our crop, soybean crop's not even in the ground, but a lot of people pre-buy for the fall, and we're not getting those orders. In the metal markets, marking time to see the next event. And in the stock market, an up day on a Monday. So let's take a look at the stocks and get a feel for what's going on. If you get my news report, I wrote today the settlement prices for traders on January 2nd, the first trading day, as to where you're at now. I won't surprise you with anything. We're little changed in most cases. But you have some markets up, some down for the year, and it's a mixed bag, and that's the key. When I look at the weekly area chart of the S&P, as long as you stay under this 18-week moving average, I do not see the market having more than a bounce in a market with overall downside bias. When we take a look at the chart, the rallies are important right here, and when I put a swing line on, you can see that the market went through the last rally high. You left your downtrend. You're not in one. You have a lower low and a higher high on a daily chart. No surprise. As I said, for the year, this market has gone practically nowhere. If we take a look, and I'll step right back here at the beginning, you take a look. This is where the market was, and in staying with that line, right here would be exactly where you're at. Come on, there's nothing going on. It's a trader's delight, but not a trend delight. When I take a look at the 18-day average of closes, I always consider that the line in the sand. So when I'm looking at moving averages, that tells me if the market got upside or downside bias. It's a filter on the swing line. And on the swing line, if you take a look also at the 200-day moving average, the market has been holding that on breaks. Let me step back here to February. I think that's been one of the keys. And so if traders have been bearish, I see them as having covered shorts there. The problem is they haven't gotten anything going to the upside. And even up between the 18 and 200 day, the market runs into trading resistance. When I look at the Bollinger Bands, they're fitting together for whatever reason right now with the 100-day average and the 200. What's the importance of that? Well, the importance of it is that the market looks at Bollinger Bands as theoretical resistance and support. And if you look, the market got up to the band, got down to the band, bounced away. And I can go over and over on the chart how that theory plays itself out. So what I see in the market right here when I put momentum on it is a market that's trying to get a bit of upside momentum. It is not trending because you have a lower low and a higher high. It has some upside bias, and should it get some really bullish news, whatever that means, maybe the resistance it can carry to that between 2708 and 2710, where I would expect to see those that are friendly to the market get out of the market up there. That's all that I can say about it. When I come to the NASDAQ, we keep hitting the upper band area. We're trying for it right now, but we haven't recently come to the lower band. And no surprise, if you look at this market at the beginning of the year, you're actually a bit higher than that. So this is one of the better markets so far, not the S&P. In the Dow, sideways action. From sideways action come trends. And similar to the S&P, you've got the Bollinger Band and you have the 100-day average with the top band. Very similar to the S&P. Again, if we take a look where the market was right at the beginning of the year, we're under that level. So we've seen the two markets that are weak, the S&P and the Dow, in comparison to the NASDAQ. And when you come to the Russell, would it be a surprise to you that this market's one of the stronger markets? If we go to the beginning of the year, right through here, you're a bit higher than that right now. What are we talking in this market? An uptrend. You've got higher lows, higher highs. Momentum is trying to point up. Resistance, the 1596 level. Support back at the 18-day average at 15,508. What breaks the 1558? What happens if you break through 1548.40? You lose the trend. How will these markets react to the Iranian announcement tomorrow? I don't even know what the announcement is, so I can't even begin to guess what the reaction's gonna be. I can tell you the VIX went down on Friday and today, challenged again the lower Bollinger Band, trying to bounce away from it, no surprise there. Look for the 18-day average and the 100-day, which come in together between 1627 and 1650 to offer first resistance. In the bond market, you've rallied up to a neutral point, which is the 18-day average of closes, that line in the sand. Momentum, slightly up, but stalling against that number. If the market continues on the rally, don't be surprised to get to the upper Bollinger Band and 100-day average of closes. If you fail, you'll know that you're in a failure mode by taking out 142.22. In the 10-year note, it's the same game plan that I just told you on the other. You're looking at a market gradually coming up. Now, the interesting part about our notes and our bonds is that I was reading today one of the ECB members, and there's 25 members of the European Central Bank that are on the Monetary Rate Policy Committee meeting. And the meeting, my head's going faster than my mouth. The next meeting of July 26th is where this gentleman, he was the Belgian representative, thought that the ECB would do a policy mix, a real mix coming in. And what was interesting to me is while they're supposed to end the bond buying program, I think it's 30 billion euros a month, in September, he thought that instead of it just ending abruptly, it might trail down fairly quick. But the more important statement to me, he doesn't see a rate hike this year given the current economic data. So instead of them starting to raise rates now, they'll do that maybe 2019. Do you have any idea what the official interest rate is that they have? What if I told you a minus 0.4%? So pretty interesting. But when they come out of the market, the question is, will they be buying? Will more people start buying our bonds? I don't know. It's just a source taken away from the market. When you take a look at TLT, the ETF, you've got lower highs and higher lows. that market's just neutral as can be going into the 18-day average. If the market takes out 118.49, I think the bear play reinstates itself. That would give you lower highs, lower lows. Momentum has flattened out. That might start to play down again. Maybe you put that into line. Let's flip this. What if you take out 119.31? You'd then get the pattern of higher lows, higher highs over the 18-day average. Could set up resistance of the upper Bollinger Band in the 100-day. So we're at a key point there. Dollar index keeps getting a bid, and that's because, remember what I explained to you, when momentum in the slow stochastic oscillator flips over, where both numbers that make it up, they're called a K and a D line, the red and the blue, when they go sideways over 80, they often run against that upper Bollinger Band, and breaks in the market keep getting bought. You haven't even had a break to speak of in this market. When you lose the red reading over 80 and it closes under 80, that's when I look for price and the 18-day average to come together. We haven't had that signal yet, and it's a flip-flop in the euro. You have the embedded bearish reading riding the lower Bollinger Band, lower highs, lower lows. Remember the bearish crossover right here that you had when the 18 went under the 100. And if you think traders don't look at bearish crossovers, this gives you an idea that maybe they do. When you look at the British pound, are we going to get a bearish crossover here? We may well. And I didn't use the word may as a pun, but that is the problem. Miss May can't seem to get anything really positive going. Will the market stall out? Don't know, but you got the embedded reading, so I still think the active play is the sellers on the rally. In the Japanese yen, on the close, you got a crossover where the 18-day average got under the 100. Now, that doesn't automatically mean the market has to go down. What it means is you've had a bearish crossover, but at the same time, let me carry you to Friday. You lost the embedded reading on Friday, which often leads to price and the 18-day average coming together. I'm still looking for the resistance in that area, and because you've got the bearish crossover, to negate it, you got to get over both averages quickly. Right now, I don't think anyone has control of the market. I think the bears have lost control with the embedded reading coming out, and I wouldn't be surprised to see the battleground shape up there. In Bitcoin, you still have the embedded reading. You lost it one day. I'm pointing to it right specifically here, and remember, you can lose it one day, you must gain it back immediately the next session that you open, otherwise it stays lost, and it did so, and it had a good gain that day, never looked back, and it's still in place. Will the market lose it again? If you lose it two times in a row, this quick, it's often a sign the market wants to back off, maybe back to the 8,800 level, that 18-day average of closes. In our daily area chart of closes of the Brent versus WTI. Tomorrow's going to be super important with the Iranian decision. It's been carrying a premium of about $6.50, and that means that U.S. is getting a good bid for our oil. There were, what, 9 more rigs or so on Friday. So at these prices, how could you not be inviting a lot of traders? By the way, the time on this isn't wrong. This is going to be, because I used the Brent in there, it's going to be European time. When we look at the June Brent, you can see how the price went right up to that upper Bollinger Band, fighting its battle there. WTI, it's $70. Got to be a dream for these guys in the oil patches. The question is the hedging that they're doing, how they're locking it in, and of course, money's getting tighter. But keep in the back of your mind, you're in an upper Bollinger Band. The odds do not favor staying over it. You're overbought, and you are not trending. Yes, I realize we could both argue that you've been trending here, and I would be the first to agree. But in the words of the swing line, you have a lower low and a higher high, which is not a clean trend. In fact, that's what we've had. We've had weird trade all for the past 2 weeks on that. Gasoline held the 18-day average, is making a run back to the upper Bollinger Band. Hard to be short this market, as I've been saying, as you're entering the driving season. And what do you hear on the news? I heard it over the weekend. Gasoline prices are moving up again, blah, blah. And we haven't begun driving. This is still May 7th. There's a whole driving season ahead of us. In the nat gas, in an interesting day, one more time, you hit the lower Bollinger Band, just like you've done here. You bounced away. You went up and made a challenge of the 100-day average, just missed it by 0.4 of a cent, 280.10 versus 279.70, outside day up. What you don't want to see is today's low taken out. I think the bears covered shorts today. You've been with a pattern, if we take out today, lower highs, lower lows. On Friday, you just missed the Bollinger Band. It's close. Oversold, and I think they didn't let the money go buy them today. So that's what I think was going on. Again, I want to remind you, my live webinar, you got the invite, but we've had a lot of people say, Ira, can you put up the click or somewhere on your video? And I'm doing it for you. So consider this your invite. You can click right up here. You will be taken on that icon right to your setup page. With that, I'm Ira Epstein. I hope you register, and I hope I see you come Thursday, 12:30 p.m. Central Daylight Time. Take care now.